Hello viewers, I hope you are enjoying your course. I am Dr. Amit Kaur, Professor and Dean Faculty of Education, Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar. Today I will be talking about one of a very pertinent concept in the syllabus of B.Ed, that is the concept of teaching and its phases. What I mean to say, phases of teaching. Teaching is viewed differently by different people. B.O. Smith said about teaching, he says that teaching is a system of actions intended to induce learning, meaning thereby there are certain systems of actions which have intentions to induce learning among learners. Similarly, S.C. Morrison said teaching is the intimate contact, interaction between a more mature personality and less mature personality, which is designed to further the education of the latter, that is student. Similarly, John Brubaker said teaching is an arrangement and manipulation of a situation in which these are gaps and obstructions which an individual will seek to overcome and from where he will learn in the course of doing so. To sum up all these definitions, teaching is an interaction basically which is happening between teacher and taught to develop three domains of personality. One is cognitive domain, second is cognitive domain, and third is affective domain. The cognitive domain involves knowledge and development of intellectual skills. This is how Bloom 1956 he specifies. He says this includes the recall or recognition of specific facts, procedural patterns and concepts that serve in the development of intellectual abilities and skills. Similarly, the cognitive domain provides a structural framework that enables us to examine the interaction of volition and goal-directed actions and distinguish these processes from related processes found in goal orientation, intrinsic motivation, locus of control, self-regulation and self-efficacy. Third thing is affective domain, which involves our feelings, emotions and attitudes. This domain includes the manner in which we deal with things emotionally, such as feelings, values, appreciation, enthusiasms, motivations, and attitudes. Similarly, we have to develop simultaneously their psychomotor domain, meaning thereby they need to coordinate between their psycho and organs, motor organs. So they need to learn how to write, how to speak, how to swim, how to jump. All these things are motor activities. So when we are teaching, we have to not only give them knowledge, but we have to provide them opportunities where they can develop skills. Second thing which is integral part of teaching, that is learning. Learning basically process is modification of behavior. Through the process of teaching, when the student's behavior is changed, and that behavior is changed through some of our own actions as teachers, when we are trying to give them practice, when we are trying to give them experiences, probably then their behavior, their change in their behavior comes, and that process is known as learning. And learning process in the context of teaching could be assessed when we understand two things very clearly. One is terminal behavior and second is entry behavior, meaning thereby when I start some topic, you know, in the classroom, I try to formulate certain questions, objective type questions. For example, I prepare 20 questions, objective type. I give that test to the students and try to assess what do they know about that content already. That is the entry behavior of the learner. Similarly, after assessing entry behavior, I try to teach, and once my teaching completes, I execute the same questionnaire to the students and then try to assess now what is their performance now, which is known as terminal behavior. So when terminal behavior, we reduce or we deduct terminal behavior scores from entry behavior, that becomes the learning outcome. Now in this context, when we see teaching seems to be quite complex social, cultural and ethical process designed in a social context. It is not simply transmission of the content, but it's much more than that. It is more scientific, and you know, if we want to make our job as teachers successful and easy, we have to make a systematic planning and teaching has to be done in different steps. And these steps, they consist of three phases. One phase is pre-active phase, which is a planning phase. Second is interactive phase, which is a execution phase. And third is a post-active phase, which is a follow-up phase. We'll discuss one by one all the phases of teaching to make us understand how teaching can be conducted in an effective and professional way. The first phase of teaching is pre-active phase. Pre-active phase, as the name implies, is concerned with the preparation of teaching. It is a preparation for classroom activity. It is also called planning stage or the preparation stage. Teacher planning is related to three basic questions. That is who, when, and why. Teaching is planned by experienced teachers and new entrants in this profession. This planning can be for the whole session. It could be for a particular unit. It could be for a week and even for daily sessions of the class. To run the program effectively, the student motivation is first prerequisite. If student is motivated, then only effective learning or effective teaching can take place. Third issue which is related to teacher planning is how. You know, when we are planning a lesson, we have to consider student interest, student motivation. And motivation probably, I think, is one of the most important thing in effective teaching and planning. There's a very popular saying, you can take the horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Now, this is what is known as intrinsic motivation. If the student is intrinsically motivated to learn, probably he learns effectively. Second thing among how is that, you know, we have to use curricular textbook, we have to use different kind of material which is to be taken into consideration while making an effective plan. And third thing is, it is not only that, you know, you have to just plan, but you have to plan and rethink lessons after teaching also. Once we teach, even then after that, we have to relook at our lesson planning. And when we are teaching, we have to take into consideration many aspects, meaning thereby the students learn very effectively if they see things. Similarly, they learn better if they are using interactive teaching techniques. If teacher is engaging them into different kind of interactions, probably they learn faster. And there is no doubt about the importance of teacher planning. It makes us better organized and more organized. So this is what has to be a part of teacher planning. Now let me come to different operations which are required in pre-active phase. There are four operations in pre-active phase. First is formulation of instructional objectives. When we are saying instructional objectives, it means I have to make certain teaching objectives in detail. So I as teacher has to formulate certain specific instructional objectives, or we call sometimes teaching objectives also, and I have to write them in a proper manner. When I'm saying proper manner, they have to be written in terminal sense and behavioral terms. For example, if I have to teach them what is rocks, so I have to specify what I have to teach them regarding rocks. So I need to define rocks. I won't, like, you know, if I can specify this in the context of writing instructional objectives, let me formulate a line which says after the instructions are over, the students will be able to, number one, define rocks. When I am writing this line that after the lesson is over, the students will be able to. Now this is what is known as terminal objective, meaning thereby I am specifying what my students will be able to learn at the end of my lesson delivery. So this makes my terminal objectives. So once I write this, it makes terminal objective, and then I specify after the instructions are over, students will be able to, number one, define rocks. Now this define is an action verb. Then second, I say will be able to list various types of rocks. Now list is again an action verb. So what I'm trying to say is, you know, when you are writing teaching objectives, they have to be very specific. Specific, when I'm saying define, it makes it specific. When I'm saying list, it makes it specific. When I'm saying explain, it makes it specific. And all these are action verbs. So the behavior of the learner after the completion of the topic is specified by the teacher in this first operation of preactive phase, that is formulation of instructional objectives. Second phase, second operation in first phase of teaching, that is preactive phase of teaching, is selection of subject matter. Selection of subject matter means that, you know, once I formulate instructional objectives, my instructional objectives are specific and in behavioral terms, and then I take into consideration what subject matter is required to accomplish the above stated instructional objectives. Now, this whole process is a little tricky. Most of the time as a teacher, what we do is we have subject matter first, maybe in the form of a syllabus or curriculum which is specified by the university, or, you know, in the form of a textbook. So we read that and then we try to formulate objectives out of it. What I'm suggesting here is little different, or just the reverse of what we routine, you know, in a routine way we do. So what I'm saying here is that we formulate instructional objectives first and then we make a selection of subject matter, meaning thereby we have to select the subject matter from different sources, maybe from the textbook, maybe from the reference book, maybe from some internet source. But the criteria of selection of subject matter is that we have to select that kind of subject matter which helps us to accomplish the above stated instructional objectives. So what is there in the textbook probably is not the criteria. The criteria is that we make a listing of instructional objectives, and for each objective we have specified subject matter which is needed for accomplishment of that objective. So this is the criteria. Choice of content or material to be taught or learning experiences to be given are also decided at this step only. So this step, that is subject matter, selection of subject matter, is very crucial from the point of view of teacher planning. Third operation in preactive phase is sequencing the ideas and style of teaching. Now, when I'm talking about this phase, it gains significance because by now I have all that content and material with me which is required for accomplishing the instructional objectives which I set for a particular class. So once I have all the content and learning experiences with me, so what I need to do is I have to sequence them. Most of the time when sequencing is done in the books, this is a logical sequencing, whereas when we have to sequence it for the classroom teaching, we have to sequence in such a manner that it hooks the attention of the student, meaning thereby there has to be psychological sequencing of the ideas. Of course, it has to be logically linked also, but the first step which we have to take has to be psychological, meaning thereby the first step should be such which hooks the attention of the learner. So content or material which is organized or sequenced has to be decided, and this decision is very crucial. The second aspect, which is again very important, is style of teaching. Many times the content itself suggests what style of teaching you have to adopt, meaning thereby there are certain occasions when teacher would like to use some kind of lecture or dissemination of knowledge. Sometimes he would like to have some discussion in the classroom. Sometimes he like the students to be engaged in some practical activities. So there are different styles of teaching which are related to the nature of the content. So here at this stage, it is not only sequencing of ideas and facts and subject matter of the content which has to be delivered, but along with that we have to take a decision that which content or which idea has to be taught through which style of teaching. So that aspect has also to be specified at this stage. And the fourth operation of pre-active phase is the development of overall teaching strategy. Now, this is the time when we as teachers have to take a decision regarding proper use of teaching aids, choice of the methods, techniques and strategies of teaching. The duration, place and management of classroom teaching is also planned at this time. Decision about evaluation tools are also taken at this point of time. Now, this all these four operations at pre-active phase completes one aspect, that is of teacher planning. Next phase of teaching is interactive phase, which is known as execution phase. In this phase, we try to implement what has already been planned. So this phase, when actual teaching learning takes place, this is the implementation stage of planned lesson. Here the teacher and taught actually participate in teaching learning process. At this stage, teacher uses a number of strategies for achieving the goals already set. Whenever the learner finds problems in understanding, the teacher has to improvise and give more examples. Success or failure of this step will reflect the interaction of the teacher and taught. Before I start with the operations of interactive phase, let me show you, you know, how a learner learns. It's a model of the learner, and you will find in this model of learner, how learner learns, how stimulus is provided based on sight, hearing, touch, smell and taste, how he store information, how he performs and how he get reinforcement and how he conceptualize the idea. You know, once we understand how the learner learns, probably it becomes very easy for us to handle interactive phase. There are few stages of few operations of interactive phase. First operation of interactive phase is sizing up of the class. This step, it refers to activity of perceiving the due size of the class as well as getting the feel of the mood of the learners. It involves perception on the part of student as well as teacher. On entering into the classroom, the teacher tries to perceive the classroom climate. The students are also perceiving the behavior and personality and capability of the learner during this time, so that a desirable interaction in the classroom takes place. So teacher tries to understand the mood of the learners. Teacher tries to understand the whole feel of the classroom, and students also tries to assess the personality and capability of the teacher during this phase. The second operation in interactive phase is diagnosis of the learner. Now, this is just a stage which is very important for giving some kind of teaching learning exposure to the students. But before we give some exposure to the students with reference to the content, we need to know where our learner stands. So he tries to assess the mental ability, attitude, interest of ourselves and of the learners, so as to make the phenomena of teaching learning easy. The learners also try to estimate about the teacher and also of themselves. So this is the place where he is trying to assess, he is trying to know what is the entry status of the learner with respect to that content which he has to deal. And the third and the most important step or operation in interactive phase is treatment given to the learner. Now, once by now he has understood the entry behavior of the learner, he has also some kind of estimation where he has to take the learners to when he takes a decision about the formulating of instructional objectives. So he knows where the learner stands right now and where he has to take those learners to. So on the basis of these two things, he know the entry point and he also know the terminal point. So now in between, teacher has to exercise his effectiveness for accomplishment of terminal behavior on the basis of by making use of entry behavior. So in treatment given to learners, there are two, three aspects, sub points. One is selection of the stimuli, then employment of the strategy, and third is feedback and reinforcement. So it is the actual interaction between teacher and taught. The moment the teacher goes in the classroom, non-verbal reaction starts between him and the students. With the speech starts the verbal reaction between the two. Through more questions put by teacher to the student, the reactive process gains momentum. When the students also put the questions to the teacher, it makes teaching all the more learnable for the students. Thus, action and reaction makes teaching go on and ultimately makes it a success. In this process, you will find the first thing is selection of stimuli. You know, when he starts the interaction, he is to create a learning environment wherein the student starts thinking why he is learning a particular content. So that stimulus which helps the learner to respond and engage himself into teaching learning process. Once that is done, then the job of the teacher is little easy. Then what he has to do is what he's already planned in the pre-active phase, he's to implement that. And when he's implementing that strategy, when he's adopting those styles of teaching, he has to continuously give them feedback and reinforcement so that the students are continuously connected. This is all about interactive phase of teaching. Now we go on to the last phase of teaching, that is post-active phase. The post-active phase concerning evaluation provides necessary feedback to the teacher and the student in bringing desirable improvement in the performance. It is related with both teaching and learning. So already on the basis of entry behavior of the students and on the basis of expected terminal behavior of the student, the teacher has already prepared a test which is already done in pre-active phase. Now that phase has to be implemented, so the teacher has to conduct a follow-up program where he want to assess whether what I taught has been attained or has been learned by the students or not. This is very important. What I expected, what objectives I formulated for accomplishment of teaching learning process, whether those objectives have been achieved or not. This is what we have to assess, that is determining exact dimension of behavioral change. So this aspect has to be assessed. Once we assess that what objectives we intended to attain, whether those objectives have been attained or not. So what we expected student to learn, whether he's learned or not, once we have that data with us, meaning thereby, if we wanted, we had four objectives, and out of four objectives, for every accomplishment of every objective, we formulated four objective type questions. So we are ending with 16 questions, objective type questions. So how many students successfully attempted those 16 questions is something which is giving us feedback whether as a teacher I taught well or not, whether students they learned effectively or not. And once we do that, we have to see that whether we have used. Now this information will be helpful to give us feedback as teachers whether I adopted appropriate testing devices and techniques or not. If the performance of the students is not appropriate, is not good, then I have to rethink, did I use the appropriate testing devices and techniques or not? Do I need to go for different kind of testing devices, maybe tests or quizzes or observation of students, or maybe comments of students, structured or unstructured situations? All these things have to be taken into consideration. Lastly, changing the strategies of teaching. If at the end of the assessment, I came to know that my performance or performance of the student was not appropriate to the expectation, I made certain instructional objectives very clear for myself, but I could not make my students attain those objectives, it means maybe there is something wrong the way I planned. Maybe there is something wrong the way I taught. Maybe there's something wrong the way I evaluate it. So at this stage, I have to take the assessment as a feedback to me also. Me means my planning and my execution. With this, probably you know, we can understand the whole concept of teaching in a more scientific way, rather than just thinking that, you know, teaching is just an art of presenting a particular content. If I have some innate abilities to make effective communication, probably I'm a good teacher. If I don't have those innate capabilities, I'm not a good teacher. That belief has to be changed with the thought that teaching is not only an art, but is a scientific process wherein we have to plan very systematically. We plan our objectives, we plan our selection of content, we plan arrangement of ideas and style of teaching, we plan our evaluation strategy, we plan the overall teaching strategy, and accordingly, we have to diagnose the learner when we go to the classroom. So this is classroom teaching execution. So we have to select appropriate stimuli, we have to effectively implement our strategy, and we have to continuously give them feedback and reinforcement. And teaching doesn't end there. Teaching continues thereafter. So with these presentation, I would like to make a submission to all my learners that teaching is to be taken very professionally. And when we are taking teaching professionally, we have to think that all aspects of teaching can be observed, can be planned, can be improved, can be modified. And with this understanding, we can make ourselves to be a better teacher through an effective teacher education programs. Thank you so much.